everybody. I'm here in Brussels with Vice President Sefcovic. Hello, Maros. And I'm extremely happy to be with all of you to spend 2.5 hours this afternoon to launch the European Raw Material Alliance, which is extremely important. So I'm extremely happy that we are all together. I will start while addressing a few comments, and then, of course, Maros Sefcovic will address, and then we will have a list of speakers, starting with my friend Peter Altmaier. Hello, Peter, from Berlin. Again, welcome to the launch of the European Raw Material Alliance. Europe has set out the ambition to be the first supplier of green energy, to be the first digital continent, and also the first continent in terms of circular economy. Making these ambitions a reality requires critical materials, such as lithium for batteries, magnets, or semiconductors. And to meet our Green Deal targets by 2030 and 2050, we will need even higher amount of those critical materials for our strategic sectors and technologies. And in supplying these critical raw materials, we rely heavily on imports from a small number of third countries. For example, China provides 98% of the EU's supply of rare earth elements. Turkey provide 98% of the EU supply of borate. And South Africa provide 71% of the units of for platinum. But there are also many of these materials present in Europe, and that's the good news. Be it cobalt, bauxite, beryllium, bismuth, gallium, germanium, indium, niobium, or borate. Europe has significant potential deposits, which we observe, by the way, by satellite through our Copernicus program. We have, for example, considerable lithium resources in Europe. We are positioning ourselves so that by 2025, we'll be almost self-sufficient in lithium for batteries. This doesn't mean, however, that we want to produce everything, of course, in Europe. Our resources are large and diversified, but they are not sufficient to cover all our needs. And that's why we want to forge major partnerships with third countries, such as, for example, Canada and Australia, and better integrate interested African countries into European value chains and to develop their economies. Because when we speak of strategic autonomy, or what is sometimes referred as to sovereignty or resilience, we are not talking about isolating ourselves from the world, but having choice, alternatives, competition, avoiding unwanted dependencies, both economically and geopolitically. And in this context, this is exactly what we must read as the Commission's action plan on critical raw material that Maros Sefcovic and I presented earlier this month together. COVID-19 disrupted global supply chains across the board. We all know that, and we all have seen it, including, of course, for raw materials. This confirmed our analysis as laid out in our March industrial strategy, that we need to think more strategically to anticipate other possible disruption in the future. We must boost our own domestic capacity for primary raw materials and for secondary raw materials through enhanced circularity. We must also ensure diversified and undisturbed access to global markets for sustainability sources raw materials while ensuring ethical sourcing and safe work conditions. Moreover, we also need to look at loopholes in the value chain. It is not sufficient to have the raw materials if we do not have the processing facilities in Europe. And we aim to do all this with the highest, of course, environmental and biodiversity protection standards. Many of these raw materials are recyclable. This is an industry and a real know-how. The recycling economy is going to be very important, and we have fully entered into an economy both of sharing but also of material efficiency, where circularity becomes extremely important. I am proud to launch together today with my friend Vice President Sefcovic, the European Raw Material Alliance, the very first action point of our plan. A few words about the purpose of this alliance. The overall goal of the European Raw Materials Alliance is to boost EU resilience in the rare earth and permanent magnet value chain that are vital for many industrial ecosystems. These industrial ecosystems bring together all actors from a sector, from large companies to small SMEs and startups, from center to research institute, and from associated services to suppliers. The member of the alliance will identify bottlenecks as well as priority actions and investment cases to tackle them. The next step for the alliance will be to address other important problems relating to critical raw materials or raw materials more generally, such as base metals. The European raw materials will follow the successful approach of the European Battery Alliance, and of course, Vice President Sefcovic will speak more about this since he has been so much involved in its development and success. It will have a flexible governance framework built on the principles of openness, transparency, diversity, and inclusiveness. The alliance will be open to companies, regions, research institutions, unions, and non-governmental organizations, covering the whole value chain. The knowledge and innovation community of EIT Raw Materials will manage the alliance, just like EIT Energy manages the European Battery Alliance. Both knowledge innovation communities were set up and are funded by an EU body, the European Institute of Innovation and Technology. EIT Raw Materials connects entrepreneurs, innovators, universities, and researchers in the field of raw materials. It is therefore an ideal guarantor for inclusiveness. Because the alliance is not about imposing solutions on anyone, and that's extremely important, it is about all key players' responsibility, taking responsibilities and working together with public support to deliver results on the ground. I am pleased to see that so far around 100 industry partners, 40 industry associations, the European Federation of Geologists and the French Ministry for the Economy and Finance have already endorsed the European Raw Material Alliance. This is a proof that this alliance meets a real need. While industrial, Green 10 and Friends of the Earth Europe are presented today, I would still like to encourage more trade unions and NGOs to participate, since it is absolutely essential that they contribute to the work of the Alliance so that it takes all aspects into consideration and is socially accepted. Yesterday, I received a letter by civil society representatives laying out their concerns about the Raw Materials Alliance. I read it with attention, of course, and I look forward to engaging with you to address legitimate concerns, including about how to engage with local communities, enforcement, third countries, or due diligence on which we are proposing rules in the upcoming batteries regulation. We need to work together and move on from the situation where Europe imports raw materials and close its eyes to problems linked to raw materials in third countries. Taking more responsibility ourselves and applying high environmental and social standards is part of the solution. The involvement of regions will be important. Regions are closest to the local communities. They know whether a project is there will have a public support or not. Together with national authorities, regions are responsible for ensuring that all relevant laws and consultation processes with local communities are respected. I hope that many regions, especially regions with a proud mining tradition, will see the potential for attracting jobs and investment through projects around sustainable raw materials value chains. For instance, Europe coal regions could specialize in sustainable sourcing of raw materials employing miners with transferable skills in the context of a just transition. In this context, I do encourage member states to include investments in critical raw materials in their national recovery plans. The alliance will not be inward-looking. As the action plan on critical raw material explains, boosting Europe's own capacities and increasing circularity will not be enough. To become green, digital, and resilient, EU industry also needs to diversify its supplies outside of Europe. The EU action plan announced our intention to develop strategic partnership with resource-rich countries. Companies from third countries that agree with the aims of the alliance will be able to join the alliance. To illustrate this, it will be my pleasure to hear this afternoon from the Honourable Seamus O'Regan, the Canadian Minister of National Resources. As a conclusion, I would like to tell you that I'm very pleased to see that all key players in the alliance are represented here today, together with representatives of several EU bodies. I am looking forward to listening to your intervention. Afterwards, there will be an opportunity to ask questions. And if we don't have time for all questions, we will answer then to the questions that you will raise on the specific tool that is at your disposal today, I believe. So I will now ask my colleague and friend Maros Sefcovic to give his opening remarks. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Thierry. Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. First and foremost, it's a pleasure to speak after Thierry because I think he very well display all the opportunities and huge task which is ahead of us. And I think it's no coincidence that the launch of this alliance is a number one action on the 10-point list under the recently adopted action plan on the critical raw materials. And the reason is simple, because only our collective efforts could lead to the success. It's really the only way. And I think that we also have to agree that we have no choice but to succeed. And yes, as Thierry already mentioned today, we are laying the foundation stone of the European Raw Materials Alliance. But the actions under this alliance will have a defining effect throughout Europe's economy as well as for its global position. With the transition to the climate neutral and digital society, our reliance on available fossil fuels risks to be replaced with a reliance on non-energy raw materials, for which the global competition is becoming more and more intense. And we have all seen how this was exacerbated by the pandemic and related disruptions in the global value chains. Therefore, we must change our approach to the critical raw materials, reduce our dependency, and also strengthen our security of supply. And to this effect, the action plan on the critical raw materials, together with the circular economy action plan, is an integral part of our recovery and resilience strategy. So if you allow me, let me focus on two areas. First, what strategic foresight tell us, and second, as Thierry already referred to, lessons learned from the EU Battery Alliance. As you all know, many strategically important industrial ecosystems in the EU depend on reliable, sustainable supply of raw materials at competitive costs. Thierry mentioned few of them, but let's repeat them just so we would be very clear why we need the success in this effort. We are talking about renewable energy. We are talking about digital, electronics, mobility, automotive and beyond, construction, as well as aerospace and defense. And we see that the demand for primary and secondary raw materials is likely to rise. For example, according to some scenarios linked to the green and digital transition, Europe would need almost 60 times more lithium and 15 times more cobalt by 2050 for electric cars and energy storage alone. And we see that the demand for rare earth used in permanent magnets, critical for products like wind generators, electromobility solutions, batteries, radars, robots, could increase up to tenfold in the same period. And on rare earth, we know we are almost exclusively dependent on China, despite interesting deposits in Europe, in France, Germany, Portugal, Spain, Sweden, or in Greenland and Norway. And we know that there is also huge potential for recycling and reuse, which we are exploring, which we are going to explore to the fullest. So in this case, foresight is clearly call for action. And I would underline a bold action to accelerate alternative pathways with much higher resource efficiency, innovation and substitution, together with the mainstreaming of recycling and second use. Integrated action to also look beyond growth at policy objectives that embrace sustainable jobs creation, environmental and health protection, quality education, and I would say all major features of the people's well-being. As a part of our first strategic foresight report, we have started to look closely at member states' wide-ranging vulnerabilities and capacities also in relation to raw materials. We also propose to discuss prototype resilience dashboards to jointly assess the progress in material demand, import dependence, criticality, trade, public awareness, resource efficiency, circularity, substitution, and innovation. And I hope that all the members of the Alliance would join us in this exercise, because we need your input, we need your contributions, we need your field experience. Then, of course, the question is how the European Union and the member states can mitigate these vulnerabilities, how can we boost our capacities and seize related opportunities. And the answers to these questions will be the key to strengthening our resilience. If you allow me just one example on recycling. If we just look at electronic waste, here we are talking about 9.9 million tons of waste, electrical and electronic equipment. Around 30% is collected and recycled, but the recovery of the critical raw materials from this electronic waste stands below 1%, because we still do not have the industrial technology how to do it better, and we still need to invest in research and innovation so we can improve our recycling and reuse of these critical raw materials. So I would say that exploiting these urban mines, which means recovering raw materials from this urban waste through recycling, could eventually satisfy a large share of the EU's demand for the critical raw materials. Thierry was kind in referring to the European Battery Alliance, and he asked me just to illustrate with a few remarks what would be the lessons learned, which would be applicable also to the work of Raw Materials Alliance. I think first and foremost, we have to mobilize, as he said, all industrial and innovation actors, member states, regions, the European Investment Bank, who is a key partner, the private investors, social partners, and civil society in order to help build our capacities along the entire value chain, from mining to the waste recovery. And our collective task would indeed be to identify the bottlenecks, opportunities, and investment opportunities or projects that should be operational already by 2025. So we have clear targets on the horizon. But beyond that, the challenge is, of course, also to substantially leverage the EU's strategic autonomy, our participation and positions in the global value chains. So if you allow me just to bring you a few facts how we manage to achieve that through that great cooperation formed under the European Battery Alliance. Because here, within 3 years, we managed to move from laggard to the front runner. In 2019, the investments in Europe into this battery sector reached 60 billion euros, which is 3 times more than in China. Also this year, in 2020 to date, the level of investment in Europe has reached 25 billion euros, which is twice as much in China. So we really became the hot zone for investment into this forward-looking, future-oriented sector. So we are well on track to become second manufacturer of the lithium-ion battery cell by 2024, meaning we would be overtaking US and the rest of Asia and be number two after China. But I'm sure that if it comes to quality, if it comes to sustainability of our batteries, we are clearly aiming it to be number one. And I have to say that thanks to the business investment platform, which is a matchmaker between investors and the projects which need the financial support and investments, we are moving from covering from 3% to 80% of our battery-related needs for lithium by 2025. And I'm sure that thanks to the great cooperation with Thierry, upcoming battery regulation proposal will also address responsible and sustainable sourcing of raw materials for the batteries. I know that we will listen in a few moments with the ministers who have been very actively participating in the European Battery Alliance, so they know this story very well, be it Peter Altmaier from Germany, Jadwiga Emelewicz from Poland, or Mikkel Intela from Finland, and they can testify to you how important our cooperation was and how we couldn't achieve this result if we would approach it with a business-as-usual approach. So we have to be a little bit disruptive, and we have to be very, very fast, and we have to be relentless. I think what would be the key to our success would be the collaboration, as I said, between various public actors, private sector, but also NGOs, regions, and financial investors, where our key partner would be EIB. And I'm extremely glad that we managed to build such a strategic partnership between the Commission and the EIB. And therefore, I am extremely pleased that Vice President Fayol will be here with us today, so he can explain us how EIB is approaching this new challenge. And of course, the second key to success is the sustainability and resilience as our main compass and the key to build our competitive advantage. So I think we can coin the term that what we are aiming at is competitive sustainability, that we can be sustainable and we can be competitive at the same time. And I believe that this would bring us not only economic success, but also more than 2.2 million jobs who are currently working in repair and materials recovery, and there is a big potential for further growth. So to conclude, I think that we have to also ask our colleagues from the EIT Raw Materials and all our participants to have a good questions, good target for us for the future. What should be our 2030 objectives? How much of recycled, reused primary and secondary raw materials we believe we can get? How can we measure our success vis-a-vis the rare earth and magnets in the future? What kind of market we imagine there will be in the coming years, and how much of that we want to capture? What kind of global partnerships we can forge? And I think to have good answers to this would help us to chart the policy and work forward. And I can assure you, as you have seen from our introductory remarks, that both Commissioner Breton, myself, but I'm sure that I can speak on behalf of other colleagues, will do our utmost to create the favorable, conducive environment for our common work. Thank you very much, Thierry.